apologizing that there is going to be no humor today. Now, you might find humor somewhere along the way, but many times I will look for illustrations that will make a point very clearly, but sometimes humorously. Today, as we work our way through this first part of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, it's not a very humorous passage, if you will. So if you have your Bible, I'm going to invite you to turn with me. The 1 Thessalonians, we are now burgeoning all the way into chapter 5. Yeah, we are just speeding right through this. About the times and seasons, brothers, and I'm going to say brothers and sisters because this word Adelphos means church or everyone, all inclusive. About this time, people, you do not need anything to be written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they are saying peace and security, there will be sudden destruction coming upon them, like labor pains coming from a pregnant woman, and they will not be able to escape. But you, brothers, are not in the dark, for this day should not overtake you like a thief. For you are all sons of light and sons of the day. Again, let me just say, sons and daughters. We do not belong to the night nor the darkness. So then we must not sleep like the rest of the world does, but we must stay awake and be serious. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, we must be serious and put the armor of faith, the love of Christ as the chest protector, and the helmet of the hope of our salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are asleep or awake, we live together in Him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up as you are already doing. Now, some of you might say, this very much looks like a continuation of chapter 4, and in some ways it is, because chapter 4 ends by saying what? Encourage one another with these words. This paragraph ends with what? Encourage and exhort, build up each other with these words. And so what we need to do and what we have to get fully understanding is that we should be able to talk about the serious things of God seriously and at the same time it ought to be encouragingly, simultaneously. Let me just say this. Jesus is. There's a lot of people still debating whether or not he was even a human historical figure, but that he is who he said he was. He said he was God in human flesh. When the disciples said, show us the Father, Jesus said this, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Now, how would I write that in the truly new international race band version? I would say, show us the Father, and Jesus would say, you're looking at it. You're looking at it. Now, there's a big difference between looking at him and seeing him. Because one, I can look and I can see Billy sitting right there. But do I really see Billy? Now, I can see his form, but do I see who he is, what he stands for, where he goes Monday through Saturday, what he does, how he loves his wife, how he raises his children? You see, what he says, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That means that when you see me operate, you see the way God loves you. And so it's more than just acknowledging that there is a blob there in front of my eyes that cannot be overlooked. It is, what does that blob stand for? What does that blob mean? What is the reputation of who that blob is? Jesus is the great unifier. That means everyone who comes to Christ is unified in Christ. The church is not unified because we all have the same idea of what color we ought to paint it. The church is not unified because we all believe that we ought to come together at certain times during the day. How many of us know that 11 o'clock for church in the United States became the church hour because it was after the early milking times and before the afternoon feeding times of the livestock? We didn't start doing church because the Bible says, do church at 11 o'clock. We did church at 11 o'clock because it was in between chores. That's why we have that. And so Paul says, whether you do church on this day or that day or this time or any time, the church ought to be about what? The unification of Christ, the unification of the glorification of Christ. We come together because of Christ, but at the exact same time, Jesus Christ is the great unifier, and he's also the great divider. The preaching of the cross is a stumbling block to the Jew and foolishness to the Gentile. For some people, if you want to start an argument, does anybody know how to push the right button to start an argument with the right person? Some people, it's politics. For some people, it's sports teams. With some people, it's religion. And if you want to start an argument, all you have to do is say, well, I went to church, you know, on Sunday, and here we go. It's cranked up again. Here we go. Jesus Christ and the cause of Christ, the gospel of Christ, is a great unifier to those who love Christ. But though those who don't, it is a great divider. And it is a very large division. He starts off this chapter by saying, and now about times and seasons. Now, I put the watch down in the bottom because ever since the beginning of time, people have always been trying to find out from God what's going to happen before God is ready to reveal it. Adam and Eve experienced that. Cain experienced that. We've been experiencing it all the way up until the time of Jesus. In the Old Testament, they would say, how long, how long, how long, how long, how long? Many times people come to church and they go, how much longer? How long? Well, I said there would be no humor, so forget about that one. How long, how long, how long? And when Jesus is about to ascend in Acts chapter 1, they look at him and they go, when are you coming back? And so Jesus says three times in the Bible, in Daniel chapter 2, in Acts chapter 1, and here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, that the phrase comes out, brothers and sisters, do not look at times and do not look at seasons. If you take both of these words and put them together into a linguistical whole, it literally means when. We know you're leaving. When are you coming back? And so the Old Testament has a lot of verses about the day of the Lord. If we were to take it out and look at Isaiah chapter 2 and Joel chapter 1, 2, we take a look at Amos chapter 5, Zephaniah chapter 1, Zechariah chapter 14. Over and over and over again, it is a unification and a diversification passages. When the day of the Lord comes, in the Old Testament it always says, one of two things will happen. You will either rejoice or you will cry out for mercy and get none. Because your time for mercy is over. We have it in time. We have an appointed time to live, and according to the Bible in Hebrews, we have an appointed time to die. And in between that time, we have God's unmerited love and grace that we can enjoy. It says, you have no need for me to write to you. Now, they have heard this teaching before. Now, how many of us in the world today even still knows who Jesus is, much less that he is coming back? Margaret taught in a school in Texas in the Bible Belt, and at Christmas time, one of the teachers on the door was able to decorate the door with a manger. So walking into the classroom with the door open, there was a manger right there, and a sixth grader looked at Margaret and said, what's that? And she said, well, that's baby Jesus' manger. And this sixth grader went on to ask this question, what does baby Jesus have to do with Christmas? And this was back in the 80s. I don't think we've gotten a lot better since then. And so there are a lot of people who don't even know who Jesus is. Now, they've heard the reports. They've watched the television shows. There's a television show that I thought I was going to like until all of a sudden I watched the episode and they were blaming everything on the Christians. I thought, well, there's another way that Hollywood, again, tries to say that the only bad people in the world are people who call the name of Christ as our Savior. He says, don't look at times and seasons. One version of the Bible will say times and dates. Another version of the Bible might say times and epochs. When was the last time you used the word epoch? Okay, well, we're going to talk about what these words mean. In the Greek, it looks like this. Chronon, kaiton, karyon. Now, time is chronos. Now, the word here for chronos is where we get, anybody ever say you have a chronos watch? Chronological watch? That means that it is keeping everything in literal definition, duration of time, from one point to the next point. I don't know what time you went to bed last night, but from the time you went to bed, and some of you might have actually turned on an alarm and you get up in this morning, that time period between the time you went to bed and the time that the time went off this morning is called chronology. There's a version of the Bible that puts the life of Jesus in chronology. It doesn't go Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It has a couple of verses from John, a couple of verses from Matthew, a couple of verses from Luke. And it shows the life of Jesus in the New Testament, called the Synoptic Gospel, or the Harmony of the Gospels. And it shows his life in sequence rather than just reading it book after book after book. Your life is lived in sequence. How many of you live on 24-hour increments called a day? All of us. And when Jesus was on earth, he lived in 24-hour increments called the day. And so what they're saying is, don't take a look at when he's coming back by just saying, I can figure out what day it will be. I can guarantee you this, that unless you get up every day and say, I think it's today, I think it's today, I think it's today, you will be wrong. You can go to eBay today, and a book that was written in 1988 said this, that Jesus will return on Christmas Day, 1988. Sold thousands of copies. Thousands of copies. Thousands of copies. And then December 26 came. And he wrote the sequel. That said he will come on December 25th, 1989. You can buy that book in original hard for 10 cents. For 10 cents at certain bookstores. They still have cases of them because they thought they'd sell cases more. Unfortunately, what did that do to the reputation of that person's theological perspective? To non-theological people. We'll talk about that some more in a minute. He says, don't try to say, all right, I can figure out which day it's going to be. And don't say, I can figure it out because I can look at the signs of the times. The word here for seasons and epoch means, well, there's a war there. There's a war there. Now, the Bible said when there's times of war, it'll probably be. The Bible says this, you're not going to know. Jesus even said this in his human experience. He says, only the Father knows. I don't even know when I'm coming back right now. Now, there's been a lot of times I've left the house and I didn't know what time I was going to come back. But it wasn't because I was God's son. It's because I have no idea what's going to happen in my day. Jesus willingly emptied himself in Lazarus. It's called epikenosis in the Greek. And that means some of who he is as God the Father, he left in heaven. And he did not retain access to everything he knows. But once he got here and they said, when? He said, it is not for you to know when, but what should you do until when comes? What had he just said? Go into all the world and preach the gospel, baptizing people in God's name, and making disciples. And instead of saying, okay, how do we do that? They go, when are you coming back? The word here is circumstances and signs. Now, there are a lot of people who have said this. I think the Lord is coming back in my lifetime. Has you ever heard anybody say that? I hear Margaret say that all the time. She said, look at how bad everything is. I think the Lord's coming back in my lifetime. Let me just say that you know there's a long list of people all the way back to Paul and Peter who said the same thing. And up until now, they've all been what? Wrong. And if all of a sudden my dependence upon who Christ is dependent upon somebody that I have respect for, and once they have been wrong, how many times is somebody wrong before you start to wane your respect? There's something we need to be doing other than taking a look at times. Jesus said, and then he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put up in heaven by his own authority. So this is the one thing that Jesus absolutely verifiably says about when the end is going to be. You're not going to know. But it will come on like a thief in the night. He warns us what it will be like, but he doesn't tell us when it will be. In Mark chapter 13 and Luke chapter 21 and Revelation chapter 3, let me just read a couple of passages for you. It says this in Mark. Be on guard, keep away, for you do not know when he will come. In Luke 21, Jesus said, take heed that you are not deceived. For many will come saying, there is the Christ, and there is the Christ, and I am he, and the time is drawn near. Therefore, don't go after them. 3 in Revelation 16 also goes on to say that a time is going to come when they are going to be caught napping. They are going to be sleepwalking. But unfortunately, too many Christians are walking in their sleep. Now, there's a big difference. Sleepwalking is your comatose. You're incoherent. You don't know that you are doing it. Unfortunately, too many Christians are choosing to sleep and when we ought to be awake. And we're sleeping our life away. You know, I heard that comedian one time say that he used to dream about going to college. And they said, well, when would you do that? He says, when I was sleeping my way through high school. We need to be fully awake. That's what this word goes on to say. It says, and you fully well know when this will come by. This word here for fully is the word where we get our word acrobat. Can anybody see how it looks like acrobat, acrobos? And it literally means to be fully, diligently, accurately, in precise motion. Now, if an acrobat is just off balance a smidge, you can go from the walking Luwinda to the falling Luwinda as you walk across the tightrope, correct? And you are only just one. And why did he carry that great big long pole? For additional balance, to counterbalance. And this is what he's saying, is that we need to be balanced as we go through the world. And it needs to be the balance holding on to the only balance of security, and that's Jesus Christ himself. So we need to, as we go out on the tightrope called life, and we all navigate it, the only way to have balance in a high-rise, volatile situation is to hold on to Christ and have his precision in motion in my life. In Matthew chapter 24, also in Luke chapter 12, it goes on to say this, if the master of the house had known exactly what time the thief was coming, he would have stayed away. Now, when was the last time somebody called you up and said, hey, I'm going to break into your house tonight between 9:15 and 9:17? Did you know that most burglaries don't happen late at night anyway? It happens at dusk, when people are used to seeing people going in and out of people's houses. People start going in and out of people's houses at 2 o'clock in the morning. They go, whoa, what's going on over there? People going in and out of somebody's house at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You go, oh, it's probably somebody who's working on it. It's going to come like a thief in the night. That doesn't mean at 2 o'clock in the morning. It's going to be when a time when everybody is mulling around and everything is going on and you just think all of this activity is normal, we're going to find the abnormal. And if I would have known when the person was coming, God's not going to give us advance warning. He has given us all the advance warning we need. It's called the Bible. Everything we need to know to be ready for when he comes has already been given to us. If they would have known. Now, I don't know about you, but just because God has totally given us everything we need to know and then we fail to apply it, we'd say, oh, but I'm not going to be guilty because I didn't know. Have you ever had somebody say, I didn't know? What does that really mean? It means like, I didn't see Billy. Now, I may have acknowledged his presence, but I didn't see Billy for who he really is. You see, when people say, I didn't know, what they're really saying is, I failed to really find out. It didn't seem important enough. It wasn't, you know, I had other things that demanded more of my attention. They will be surprised that they will be out of balance in their acrobat. It says, and then in verse 3, and then when they're saying peace and security, suddenly, while they are saying this, peace, while they're saying peace and security, peace and prosperity, everything is good, all of a sudden, it says that then, suddenly, destruction will come. It's interesting that this word here for peace is not shalom. It's the word irene. And the word irene in the Greek literally means tranquility or good wishes. You know, so if you see somebody and say, I wish you well. Have a good day. We'll even say it this way to make it sound spiritual. I'll be praying for you. Now let me just say, don't tell somebody you're going to pray for them and then not. Because you're not only lying to them, you're lying to God as well. Or you're making prayer frivolous. Prayer is talking to the Creator, Sustainer of the universe. That's not a frivolous conversation. And so this word for irene literally doesn't mean the absence of worry because of the presence of God. It just means I wish you well. Somebody sneezes, everybody says what? Bless you. Yeah, they'll even say God bless you. Some people will say gesundheit. What are we really saying? Don't give me that disease. You should have stayed home today. And so when I wish somebody well, I don't even necessarily mean. My dad would always say, have a good one, when he left people. You know anybody that says that? Have a good one. And my first question, my dad was, a good what? Yeah. A good what? It could be subjective. I mean, if my day is based on what I think I need to make me happy, Jerry should have given me his motorcycle. I'd have killed myself, but he should have given me his motorcycle. All right, the other word then for security is this word, asaphaleia. That literally means this, a firm foundation. But how many of us know that when we think we have a firm foundation, it can erode awfully quickly? Now, I told you I've got a picture of me standing by a sign that says, do not come out here because these cliffs fall apart. So I've got a picture of me standing there leaning on the sign. Down in, it's in Seaside or Solano Beach or somewhere down there. So here I am leaning on a sign that says, don't come out here because the erosion is dangerous. The next time I went, I wanted to take a sequel to the sign. And guess what? It was gone. It wasn't there anymore. And when we talked to some people, they said that there were some people at the bottom of that cliff when it fell apart. So it wasn't just it was gone. There were some people who were. So whether you think you know, you're in control of your time on the top, or whether you think you're in control of your time on the bottom, you're not in control of your time. Eternal. And so it says to have a firm foundation, but what I think is firm may not be all that firm. You know, if anybody, I used to live in very cold environments where we would actually drive our cars out on the lakes. Anybody live in those kinds of environments? And you could go out there and you would go like this. Well, it seems firm to me. According to what? When we would ice fish, you would literally have to get a big auger. Do you guys do that up in Wisconsin? And you drill through the ice, and sometimes you'd have to drill 3 feet down to get into the water. And the first question I ask is, why? I thought fishing was supposed to be when it's like 85 degrees, what a worm. The fishing pools are really this long. And they have a little bell at the end. On video. And you drop them in the water, and the fish are predominantly dormant. It sort of swims into the bait and hooks itself. Because it thought it was in firm foundation. Now, how many of us get hooked unaware because we're in dormant, walk sleeping in our Christian life? The mantra was, all is well. Look at it, it says peace and security. Does anybody like that word mantra? Anybody ever hear that word before? How many of us know that mantra comes to us from Buddhism? The Buddhism has mantra. Mantra literally means this in the Buddhist faith. It means saying something over and over and over again until your spirit and mind feels that it is true. We call that in the psychological world cognitive dissonance. It means saying something over and over and over again until you finally believe it. I had a car, I told you. The car was a junker. It was a piece of trash. I needed to sell it. I would have gone into the army. I needed to get rid of it before I was home on leave. So I wrote up a thing in the paper, you know, 1964 Dodge Dart, 3-speed on the column, stereo echo reverb chamber in, and I ended up keeping it. It was junk. But by the time I wrote the announcement to put into the paper, I said, I'd be a fool to get rid of this car. Now, there's no humor today, so take that very seriously. So we have the mantra. And what is the mantra? Peace and security, all is well. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 12, it says, if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you do not fail and fall and sink. It's when I think I no longer need the balance. And who is the only balance for all of life? When I think I can transfer life without Christ, that's when I'm most liable to fall, even as a Christian. Did you know that being sincere and being fully convinced does not make me right? It says, when I'm really convinced that it's a time of peace and security, they are just saying that everything is so good, it can't possibly, they're probably not even really a God. Look at how good everything is. Just because I'm convinced and just because I'm sincere, I've heard a lot of people say it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you're sincere. Yes, it does. I was eating at a restaurant in Georgia, and the waitress came up, and I was with the youth pastor and several other religious people, and the waitress came up and heard that we were talking about religion. She said this, you know what, it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you really believe it and hold on to it firm. I said, I'm so glad you feel that way because I really, really, really love to kill waitresses. And she went, I said, you just told me it doesn't matter what I believe. If I really love it and really am sincere about it, it's good, right? And all of a sudden, she had a whole different opinion of her philosophy and worldview when it was her life on the line. We need to be bibliocentric in our world. What does that mean? If God's word says it, I not only acknowledge it to be true, but then I live under the authority in which it has been given. I can't just say, oh yeah, the Bible's right, and then live wrong, and then claim to be right with God. If the Bible is right, I need to do the Bible. I need to be faith in action, not just faith in concept. We need to be bibliocentric in our worldview. Back in the time that this was written, the Romans had a thing called Pax et Securitia. And literally what that means is that the Roman Empire promised peace and safety and security to all who submitted to Rome. So when they would go in and decimate a village, they would say, Pax et Securitia. We'll take care of you now. Anybody remember there was an old movie and book called The Mouse That Roared? And it was about a whole country saying, how's the best way to cure our economic woes? And it was to get defeated by America, because then they'll take care of us. So they got in their boats, they came to America. It just so happened it was like during a disaster time when they were doing an air raid drill. And they were able to walk right into the White House, and they destroyed America. They took over, conquered America. And then they said, now what do we do? You see, there was no peace and there was no security. And there's no peace and security either unless we're hanging on to the balance, the akrobolas of Jesus Christ. It says suddenly. This word suddenly comes to all of us. Anybody experience a suddenly? I mean, I've seen people that all of a sudden walk in and just like I'm walking right by here, and see that little thing like that and just reach over like this and throw their back out. I mean, seriously throw their back out. I've seen people walk, and just a little lip can all of a sudden catch the tip of their shoe, and they come all the way down, can do tremendous damage to their face. We know a little girl that she got out of her car, and the car pulled up at a boiled peanut stand. In Georgia, they boil the peanuts in oil. To me, it sounds like human sacrifice, but they boil the peanuts in oil. And she got out of the car, and she ran around the front of the car, and she ran across the front so that she could go over and get some boiled peanuts, and a car pulled around the corner doing no more than 5 miles an hour and bumped her, and it just so happened she hit her head just right and killed her right there on the side. Member of our church that I had baptized. Suddenly comes to all of us in many, many different ways. Now, the great thing is, and the great difficulty is at a time like that for a girl who has been baptized and saved, it unified her with Christ forever in heaven. But for many of us, it divides us from Christ forever in heaven. So Jesus is not only the great unifier and divider here, he is the great unifier and divider eternal. It says, and all of a sudden, suddenly, in the time when we're crying out peace and safety, destruction comes. But destruction is this word, aletheos, that literally means to ruin or to rot. If we're living our lives believing that Jesus is not going to come back, or not caring that it's going to come back, or not caring that I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing and living like I'm supposed to be doing, we are ruining our time period. I bought some almond milk. Anybody buy almond milk? I bought some almond milk, and I froze one. Bought two what do you call those things? Cartons. Buy two cartons of those. Use one, froze one. And guess what? You can't freeze that stuff. And thaw it back out. I thawed it back out, got it out, poured it out, and all of a sudden, all of the water and the almond separated and refused to go back together again. The refrigerator was the great unifier and divider. It unified it into one supplement until it was thawed out. And as soon as it thawed out, and I just thought that if I was poured it into a larger thing, I could stir it up. Guess what? I poured it into a larger container. I stirred it up. Within a second, all the almonds went to the bottom and all. And guess what the Bible says? That a day will come when he will separate the weeds from the tares. And he will separate the wolves from the sheep. And no matter how hard you try to stir yourself into the right mixture, it is now is the time. Today is the day. Don't ruin your life. In Revelation chapter 9, verse 6, it says this, and in those days, on that day, people will seek death and not find it. It says they will be longing to just die, and death will flee from them. Because eternal life is either eternally with Christ, enjoying, or eternally without Christ, and eternally dying. Now, how many of you have ever really had a lot of pain? And you just knew, if I could just take some pain pills, or if I could just get some sleep, or if I could just get some rest, or if I could just, there is no if I could just in eternity. It is eternal. I love verse number 4. Take a look at verse number 4. But you. People get a little bit tense when I say this, but I love the but verses of the Bible. But you. What is he saying? This is not what God has intended for his children. We were not intended to be people of darkness and people who would be overtaken by the thief. But you, I could even say this, but we, if we believe in Christ, if we have been elected, we're not supposed to be in darkness. The word here for darkness is this word, skotos. It literally means to be punished in misery. It doesn't mean to just not know. It means to not know and not care and then receive the consequences. Unfortunately, we live in a world where we don't necessarily believe in consequences anymore. We believe someday if somebody does something wrong, there's always a loophole. There's always a way around it. We had this one young man who took one of those real long pea shooters. Do you remember those pea shooters? And he was, you could put like a little pea or a spit wad in there, and instead of just being a little straw, it was like 3 feet long. Took it to school and had little ball bearings. And was putting the ball bearings in the pea shooter and was shooting people, and actually they were embedding in the people's skin. And so sure enough, he was caught. He was taken to the office, but his dad was a big-time lawyer in Atlanta. I called him Matlock. And guess what? Got his son completely off and brought charges against the school. Now let me just say the charges didn't stick. But a lot of times you get somebody off, you got to countersue. You see, you can't countersue Christ. There will be consequences. And although we may think we can get out of it in the world, there will come a time of darkness. He somehow or another, he says this in the midst of saying, and it's like going into birth pains. The natural thing about birth pains is to have a baby. You know, how many times, ladies, have you heard somebody say, think I'm going to have a baby? Think I'll stop. Not today. Not right now. I've got somewhere else to go. There's no humor today. Now stop it. There's no laughing. The natural result is when you go into labor, you have a baby, but you know what's really unfortunate? Some people have stillborns, but they still have. You see, there are going to be people going through the labor pains of death, but instead of a new life, they end up with a new death. And that's what he's talking about. He said, the event that God did to bring us joy, they go through that event and all they find is ruin and destruction. Because Jesus and the preaching of Christ is the great unifier, and at the same time, it is the great divider. There are verse after verse after verse after verse after verse after verse after verses after verse talking about all of this. Let me just read this 1 John 1 for us. And please feel free to look all these up. They're incredible verses. But in 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, it says, this is the message we have heard from him. John said, I got this message from Jesus. This is not my own thing. He said it. I heard this message from him, and then we proclaim it to you. If Jesus said, this is what you need to say, that'd probably be a pretty good thing to say. He said, this is what we have heard from him, and we proclaim to you that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. There is no punishment. There is no misery. In Christ, we may go through the world with tribulation, but we find that even in the darkest of hours in human existence, there is the bright light of Jesus Christ in the midst of all that. We do grieve, the Bible says, but not as those who have no hope. And he says, because of that, in him, there is no darkness at all. And if we say we have fellowship with God, and we continue to walk in darkness, we're nothing but a liar and practicing not. Our faith ought to change our conduct. But there's something wrong with the definition of our faith. That's what all these verses say in the Old Testament. He says we are supposed to be children of God. And the children of God, he says in this passage, are children of light. That means that we become different when we are born again in Christ. Old things must pass away. Behold, all things, what? Become new. I become a new person. Chuck Swindoll wrote this, or not Chuck Swindoll, but Warren Wisdom wrote this. There's a difference between being ready to go to heaven and being ready to meet the Lord. You see, a lot of us would like to go to heaven, but I don't necessarily know I'm ready to meet the Lord. You see, for one, anyone who has sincerely trusted Christ for salvation is ready to go to heaven. Christ's sacrifice on the cross is taking care of that. But to be ready to meet the Lord at the judgment seat of Christ is quite another matter. Scripture indicates that some believers will not be happy to see Jesus Christ at all. And now, little children, abide in him, and what he shall appear, and we may be confident and not be ashamed. Why would he say not be ashamed? Because some people will, including the elect. Because why? We were children of light, and we chose to stay in the darkness. I don't want to know that. I've actually had people tell me, don't tell me because then I'll be accountable. I don't want to know. Therefore, encourage. Verse number 11. Therefore, encourage. But it says a little bit different. And build up. This word here for build up means look up. It's to have an outlook with an uplook. How do we encourage somebody? Is we get them to re-see what's going on in their lives by looking up and finding God can answer it. And if our outlook is an uplook, it will change our outcomes. This is just absolutely true. If our outlook on who God is in the world in which we live, and we consistently are looking up to find the answers, to look out into the world in which we live, it will change our outcomes. Let's put all of this together. What are the central truths we're going to talk about today? No human knows when Jesus is coming back. So because of that, it's going to take all of us suddenly by surprise. Now because of that, non-believers are going to be led into a great time of destruction. Believers are going to be led into a new time of new birth. When people are yelling out peace and security, don't fall into that trap. Instead of looking for peace and security, hang on to the balance pole in your acrobat of life until he comes. Now, there is a tremendous little book written by Dr. Holmes, and he says this, in light of this, what should we do until the Lord comes back? We should be in service, not in speculation. Written about this particular passage. He says, number one, since no one knows, quit wasting our time trying to figure it out. He's already promised us we're not going to. So stop spending so much time on speculation when we could be serving one another. Number two, he says, it often produces a wasted amount of resources. How many people have spent bunches of money producing and promoting books that you can now buy for 10 cents on eBay that are absolutely obsolete? Now, the cause of that is it brings ridicule to Christ. We talked about this Tuesday night in the adult Bible study in here, that the people in there, including Sharon, who said this about her dad, and we all love Pastor Brad, but Pastor Brad would always say, the Lord's coming back in my lifetime, the Lord's coming back in my lifetime, the Lord's coming back in my lifetime. And now Sharon is dealing with people who said, was Pastor Brad wrong? And the answer to that is, yes. Even the Pastor Brad can be wrong. Could Christ come back in my lifetime? Absolutely. Could he wait another millennia? Absolutely. Absolutely. And unfortunately, when we do that, we develop a crisis mentality. The only time we think about Christ is when we're in crisis. Well, maybe he's coming back. I better clean myself up. Dr. Douglas Moo. I just love that name, don't you? Wouldn't you like to go through life? Dr. Moo? Dr. Moo? Dr. Moo? He says, by doing this, he says, they, now that are the people who try to set the times and the seasons, they are trying to determine Christ's imminent return only as they see the signs interpreted by them. So they're saying the only way to tell when Christ is going to come back is by looking at the signs of the times. But who's in control of interpretation of signs and the times? They are. And the times that they put in place. We need to just quit doing all of that. We need to live expectantly. Could Jesus come back today?
Sure.
Am I ready? Now, not am I ready to go to heaven, but am I ready to stand face to face in front of him and to see him and be seen as he is? I all my life growing up as a kid, when I wasn't a Christian but was sent to church, I had heard pastor after pastor after pastor say, would you want to be doing that when Christ came back? And I always don't care what I'm doing when Christ came back. Let me just say, I care now. I do care now. Live expectantly. Live with eternity's values in view. Pastor Darrell prayed that we would have better use of our finances. What does Jesus say? Do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust do things corrupt. But lay up for yourselves, what did Pastor Darrell pray? Treasures in heaven, where nothing can destroy. We need to be living expectantly with eternal values in view. Live in service, not speculation. I told you about that man when I lived in this one town. He'd call me up periodically during the week, and he would want to argue that he had figured out when the Lord's coming back, figured out when the Lord's coming back, figured out when the Lord's coming back, and why he was right, and why he was right, and why I was right. And I started off thinking that maybe he wanted dialogue. No. When I said, well, what about this word? What about this word? He didn't want dialogue. He just wanted to force his opinion upon me. And finally, one day it dawned on me that his son was in Margaret's classroom at school. So I said, well, you know when the Lord's going to come back. When are you going to get serious and start witnessing to your son? Because you and I both know he's not saved. Click! Hung up. I said, I wish I had said that about 6 months ago. We should be in service, not speculation. You know, it was more important for this man to know when Jesus was coming back than he cared at all about where his son was. Because if our outlook is driven by our outlook, it will change our outcomes. Right here and right now. So what should we do between now and then? We should be walking as children of the Lord. I love this picture because that child has no idea the danger that's in front of him. And he does not care. He's just enjoying. God wants us to enjoy life. But where is God? First of all, you'd say, where's his parents? They're probably the one taking the picture. God has given us a big, beautiful, amazing world. He said, I've given all of this to you for you to enjoy. But at the same time, we need to be walking as children of the light. In the very same places that everybody else is walking. And yet, with the acrobat. Father, I want to thank you so very much for this morning. And I thank you for this paragraph. And Lord, you know we could speak on this for the next 6 months, and it's just barely still scratches the surface. But Lord, if we haven't heard anything other than we're not going to know when, but we need to be ready now. And we're not going to know when, but we need to be stop speculating and being involved in service now. That we might do so much more. Sit around and look up into heaven, looking for when the man who ascended would descend. May we truly be about great commission. May we do be about great compassion. May we be about great love and affirmation. And may we encourage one another and build each other up, just as we are now doing, even more, until the day that either the under Father, if there is anyone here today or by way of the television ministry that does not know you as Lord and Savior, and they've heard all of the facts and they've heard all of the rumors, but they still haven't really looked at Christ from a spiritual and from a love standpoint, I pray as we go into February and we think about the great Valentine's, that we would remember that the greatest love gift that has ever been given is the Son of God, who gave himself as a ransom to pay the penalty of my sin, so that I could receive and be drawn to receive the grace of salvation